William Morrow and Harper Audio present 13 Things Mentally Strong Women Don't Do. Own your power, channel your confidence, and find your authentic voice for a life of meaning and joy. By Amy Morin. This is the author. Disclaimer. This audiobook contains advice and information relating to healthcare. It should be used to supplement rather than replace the advice of your doctor or another trained health professional. If you know or suspect you have a health problem, it is recommended that you seek your physician's advice before embarking on any medical program or treatment. All efforts have been made to assure the accuracy of the information contained in this book as of the date of publication. This publisher and the author disclaim liability for any medical outcomes that may occur as a result of applying the methods suggested in this book. To all the women who strive to become a little stronger today than they were yesterday. Introduction. I grew up driving an ATV and catching night crawlers to use as fishing bait. I never liked dolls, I wasn't interested in makeup, and I hated to shop. But my skin, knees, messy hair, and dirty fingernails made for a wonderful childhood. My parents convinced me I could do whatever boys did, and I certainly tried. Whether it was racing the boys at recess or arm wrestling them into submission, I was able to keep up most of the time. But I wasn't trying to prove anything. I was just having fun. The first time I recall encountering the word sexist is when I was in the 7th grade. My algebra teacher always asked a sports-related bonus question that had nothing to do with math. But if you got the answer correct, he added 5 points to your test grade. It was frustrating that 5 points hinged on knowing who ran the most yards in Sunday's football game or who scored the most points in last year's NBA playoffs. But no one complained. One day, I was sick and had to stay home from school. I missed an algebra test, so I had to stay after school the following day to make it up. The bonus question was about a Major League Baseball player. Fortunately, I loved baseball, and I knew the answer. My teacher handed the graded test back to me the next day at the beginning of class. Written across the top of the page in red ink were the words, 0 bonus points. You only got this right because one of your friends told you the question ahead of time. I was horrified that my teacher thought I cheated, but I didn't say anything to him. I didn't know what to say. So I brought the test home and showed my dad. My dad promptly wrote a note back to the teacher. Amy owns more than 10,000 baseball cards, and she watches baseball games on TV with me every week. But because she got your bonus answer correct, you accused her of cheating. She knew the answer fair and square. But what's not fair is that you ask sports-related questions that have nothing to do with math. Clearly, you are trying to give the boys an advantage since most 13-year-old girls aren't following professional sports that closely. I gave the note to my teacher the next day and quickly took my seat. When he was done reading it, he announced to the class, "I can't give you bonus questions anymore because someone's father thinks I'm sexist." That was the last time my teacher ever gave us a bonus question, and that was the first time I really thought about sexism. It occurred to me that he didn't assume my friends told me any of the math questions ahead of time, just the sports question. And he assumed I couldn't possibly know the answer to an obscure baseball question unless I cheated. I can't help but wonder if he would have made that same assumption if I was a boy. That happened 25 years ago, and I'd like to think teachers aren't still giving boys an unfair advantage in the classroom. But research shows it's still happening. And we'll talk more about those specifics later on. I'd also like to think students and parents wouldn't be so tolerant of something like that these days. Back then, no one said anything, and neither did their parents. We tolerated it. Had my teacher not accused me of cheating, I don't know if my father would have raised the issue. My ideas about sexism have certainly shifted since the 7th grade, and thankfully, so have our cultures. Still, women continue to face unique challenges in today's world. I've seen it in my therapy office, as well as in my own life. My interest in mental strength is personal. When I landed my first job as a therapist, I was excited to help people overcome the challenges they faced. I was armed with a master's degree and knowledge I'd gleaned from my textbooks, college lectures, and internships. During my first year as a therapist, however, my mother passed away suddenly and unexpectedly. My quest to learn about mental strength became personal. I started studying everyone who came into my therapy office on a deeper level. I realized that some people were more likely to get better than others. They bounced back faster, they were hopeful about the future, and no matter what problems they faced, they persisted. I wanted to know what specifically made these people tick. Then, in a cruel twist of fate, on the 3-year anniversary of my mother's death, my 26-year-old husband, Lincoln, died of a heart attack. Being a 26-year-old widow was a surreal experience. The grief was overwhelming at times, but I knew that allowing myself to experience painful emotions was part of the healing process. By then, I was armed with new knowledge about mental strength. I had discovered that people who persevered in life didn't just have healthy habits. They were also intentional about avoiding the unhealthy habits that would keep them stuck. I was starting to see clear patterns in the people I worked with. Those who were intent on reaching their greatest potential refused to indulge in counterproductive bad habits. The key to their progress wasn't just what they did, it was more about what they didn't do. I applied what I'd learned to my own life as I worked through my grief. It took several years for my heart to heal. I was fortunate enough to find love again when I met Steve. But shortly after we got married, Steve's dad was diagnosed with terminal cancer. I found myself thinking things like, this isn't fair. Why do I have to keep losing my loved ones? But I knew that allowing myself to indulge in self-pity was one of those bad habits that would drain my mental strength at a time when I needed it the most. So I wrote a letter to myself reminding me of all of those bad habits that could keep me stuck in a place of misery. When I was done, I had a list of 13 things mentally strong people don't do. I read over the list many times in the following days, and the reminders of what not to do gave me some solace. I decided if I found that list helpful, maybe others would too. So I published it online, hoping my message on mental strength might resonate with someone else. Within a matter of days, the article went viral. It was read by more than 50 million people. Before I knew it, media outlets like Forbes and CNN were asking me about my list. My article didn't explain the context of the list, however, so everyone assumed I'd written it because I'd mastered everything on it. But the truth was, I still needed a reminder to avoid those 13 things. I was grateful to have the chance to write the book 13 Things Mentally Strong People Don't Do to explain the story behind the viral article. And when readers kept asking me how to teach kids to be mentally strong, I was thrilled to be able to write 13 Things Mentally Strong Parents Don't Do. Since I began talking about mental strength, I've fielded many questions from women, especially in light of the Me Too revelations. And while the principles of mental strength are the same for everyone, women experience different cultural pressures than men. Consequently, there are some specific bad habits that we're more likely to engage in, struggle with, and experience compared to our male counterparts. The three components of mental strength. Mental strength is a lot like physical strength. When it comes to growing stronger and becoming better, good habits are important. But your good habits will only get you so far in life if you're performing bad habits right alongside them. If I wanted to grow physically strong, I might lift weights. But if I really wanted to see some muscle definition, I'd need to give up eating too much junk food. Otherwise, my workouts wouldn't be all that effective. The same can be said for your mental muscles. You need good habits, like gratitude, to grow stronger. But if you really want to see results, you also have to give up bad habits, like comparing yourself with other people. It's important to note that having a mental illness doesn't mean you're weak. Just like someone with diabetes could choose to become physically strong, someone with depression can choose to become mentally strong. An illness can make building muscle more complicated, but it's still possible. You aren't either mentally strong or mentally weak. Everyone possesses mental strength to a certain degree. And no matter how strong you are, there's always room for improvement. It's important to keep working your mental muscles, too. If you grow lax about building strength, your mental muscles will atrophy. There are three parts to mental strength. Thoughts. It's important to develop a realistic inner monologue. Thinking overly negative thoughts like, "I'll never succeed," will drag you down. But you also don't want to think in an overly positive way. Saying things like, "This will be easy," could cause you to enter a situation unprepared. Feelings. While it's healthy to experience a wide range of emotions, you don't have to let your feelings control you. If you wake up in a grumpy mood, you can take steps to feel better. When you're angry, knowing how to calm yourself down can prevent you from doing something you regret. The more mental strength you build, the more aware you'll become of your emotions and how those emotions affect your choices. Behavior. No matter what circumstance you find yourself in, it's important to take positive action. Whether you go to the gym when you're tired or you speak up in a meeting when you're filled with self-doubt, your choices can change your life. Even if you can't solve a problem, you can always choose to make your life or someone else's life better. All three aspects of mental strength are interrelated. If you think, "I don't have anything valuable to say," you'll feel awkward about speaking up. That, in turn, will likely affect your behavior, as you'll probably stay silent. Consequently, your belief that you don't have anything to add to the conversation will be reinforced. We all get caught up in negative patterns like this in our lives. Building mental strength disrupts those unhealthy cycles and helps you develop better habits so you can live a more fulfilling life. Why the focus is on women. I wanted to write a book for women that portrays strength in an accurate light. While many people refer to Navy SEALs as the epitome of mental toughness, women, who tend to be more nurturing and place more value on relationships, can also exemplify mental strength. You don't have to suppress your emotions, deny your pain, or push yourself to your physical limits to be strong. Studies show women find that mental strength plays an important role in their lives. In 2015 and 2016, Kellogg surveyed 6,000 women across the globe about inner strength. Here are a few of their findings. 92% of women said inner strength is important in today's world. 90% of women consider inner strength to be the key to success. 71% of women feel that with more strength, they could reach their full potential. 82% of women wish they possessed greater reserves of inner strength. Clearly, women want to be mentally stronger, but many aren't sure how to build their mental muscles. I wrote this book for women with two goals in mind. One, empower women to build their mental muscles so they can become the strongest and best versions of themselves. Two, encourage women to create a ripple effect that will inspire others to become mentally stronger. I've interviewed women from across the country, and in this book, I'll share their stories, challenges, and strategies. I'll also share case studies from my therapy office that show what happens when women give up the bad habits that rob them of mental strength. The following 13 chapters aren't meant to be a checklist of things you either do or don't do. We all engage in these unhealthy practices at one time or another, especially when we encounter adversity. There have probably been times in your life when you felt strong, powerful, and unstoppable. But those instances may feel few and far between. You've probably also caught glimpses of how strong you could be, like in those moments when you almost make a brave move. Wouldn't it be nice to draw upon your inner strength all the time so you can reach your greatest potential? This book is meant to help you do just that. I'm not going to tell you you need to be doing more grueling activities to live a better life. There are too many messages out there already insisting you should be doing more to improve yourself. Instead, I'll explain how to give up the bad habits that are draining you of the strength you've already tried so hard to build. I'll teach you how to work smarter not just harder, so you can become the best version of yourself. Chapter 1. They don't compare themselves to other people. Every flower blooms at a different pace. Susie Kasem. Kara began therapy because she felt like she wasn't as happy as she should be. She was a 28-year-old nurse, and she loved her job in the pediatric unit of a hospital. She'd been with her boyfriend for almost a year, and she felt confident that he was the one. She had a great relationship with her parents and her older brother, and she had plenty of friends. She was doing well financially thanks to the house she inherited when her grandmother passed away. Without rent or a mortgage, she'd paid off her student loans early. Despite having everything she wanted, she felt dissatisfied, and that caused her to feel guilty and ungrateful. She worried that her displeasure was a slap in the face to her parents, who had sacrificed so much to give her the tools she needed to build a great life.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.